My voice are clear or not?
Clear.
Okay.
Yes, Mr. Muhaimin.
Okay, welcome to everyone to today's sessions. I'm Muhaimin Zulhair, or you can call me Zul from Universitas Brawijaya. Firstly, I'm sorry for not displaying conference virtual background due to my computer requires green or blue screen background. Today, I will be chairing this session in which we have six speakers who will present their ideas and works. The order will be following the listed speakers on the schedule. Before we start, here are some guidelines for the presenters and participants. Firstly, each speaker will speak for 10 minutes, followed by other speakers. I will remind the speaker when the time is only 1 minute left. Secondly, after all speakers finish their presentation, we open questions and answer session for 30 minutes. We hope that the discussion will be quite interactive so the participants can write the questions and comments in the chat box or asking live questions, simply use the raise hand functions on the participant button. Thirdly, we are going to record both the audio and video of this session. So if you do not wish to be recorded, simply do not use your audio and video. Okay, without further ado, it's now time to welcome our first speaker, Mr. Muhammad Anas. Mr. Anas, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I will present a paper entitled Active Tolerance Among Religious People Based on a Local Genius in Social Practice of the Jamuran Community Sokodadi Wakir Malang. Ini saya baca bahasa Inggris, Mister. Nanti kalau tanya jawab pakai bahasa Indonesia. Okay, background. This paper, amid recently increasing intolerance symptom and pattern in various practice in some societies, has conducted research by the Wahid Institute, Alfara Research Center, BNPT, and Impartial. It is necessary to re-examine known Indonesian tolerant culture as a social practice that is not only an acknowledgement and even respect for those different religions, but also an active tolerant practice, desire to live together and to work together in difference. The paper described the social practice of tolerance based on local genius. The data in the file are collected through observation and interviews. This research article based on qualitative research with grounded theory observes the file and on perspective or approach of sociology which the construction of Sukodadi Wakir community understanding on tolerance and its practice has its own peculiarities or it can be cited as local knowledge. There is three form tolerance in Dusun Jamuran Sukodadi Malang. Number one, celebrating religious holidays, Anjang Sana, inclusively during and mortality due. And three, praying together at Bersih Desa program. Celebrating religious holidays, Anjang Sana. Villagers maintain conduciveness of religious holidays celebrated by every religion. After celebrating religious holidays, they visit each other's house. Jadi setelah menjaga masing-masing tempat ibadah itu kemudian saling berkunjung ke rumah. A tolerance practice by villager in celebrating religious activities and holidays is manifested in the form of guarding worship place and shaking hands after worship on holiday. They argue that friendship relation precedes religion, so there is no reason to fight each other on behalf of religions. Thinking that friendship relations are guided by the religion, in fact, become a strong knowledge base in practicing mutual care during celebrating religious activities and holidays. The local knowledge grow and develop in the Jamburan village Nodai. If this religious thinking is compared with thinking as formulated by NU, Nahdlatul Ulama, covering first Muslim Brotherhood, Ukhuwah Islamiyah, National Brotherhood, Ukhuwah Wataniyah, Zuman Brotherhood, atau Ukhuwah Basariyah. The concept of local knowledge that proceeds humanity first is actually quite effective in building an attitude of tolerance. In addition, an understanding of action of religion is also sufficient to support the practice of tolerance. Religion is not understood as a rite that emphasizes the difference of each dogma, but religion is a spiritual path of teach human being a good way of life. Jadi tidak dipahami sebagai dogma, tetapi sebagai bagian dari kehidupan manusia. The second, yang kedua, inclusively bring and mortality dues. Various religious people can participate in bring. Furthermore, they help each other for preparing the funeral. Funeral management member consists of interfaith villager. They also pay mortality due. Jadi sampai membayar iuran kematian. The practice of tolerance is that they help each other in the burying process. Related to his practice, they hold the principle that the death is an event that must happen to all human beings regardless of the religion by embrace to. This principle is to profound that is encourage the community to work together to have proper vulnerable facility and infrastructure, as well as to help relieve the living family. The same feeling that death will happen to everyone, encourage plural action, humanistic action, or ethical action that no longer question their religion. The implication of understanding that death will happen to everyone regardless of religion appear in the interfaith burial area. Zuman certainly do not now think that are eschatological. It is beyond the limit of Zuman ability. Eschatological concept of major religion often have an impact of partitioning term that are only for certain religion. In Dusun Jamburan, it does not have an impact on distinguishing grave based on religion. Grave are grave, place where our body of the deceased are buried. Grave are nothing to do with the belief in life after death. Kuburan or tomb is more interpreted in the dimension of humanity, respect for humans by burying their body humanly. This locally understanding pattern encourages villagers simultaneously to work together in helping the process of funeral and burial that are inclusive regardless of religion. Yang ketiga, praying together at Bersih Desa program. Its religious people pray in turns. The practice of tolerance in at Bersih Desa program is that each of them read prayer in turn. Related to the community's cosmological view on Bersih Desa tradition, which must be carried out every year. They believe that if the tradition is not carried out, it will bring disaster. This view is believed by all religion adherents, both Hinduism, Islam, and Christianity, and the other, sampai pada aliran kepercayaan juga. This local knowledge actually become the epistemological basis of religious tolerant practice. Villager gather in place that are considered sacred, namely punden. Di punden itu tempat di mana semua orang berkumpul. Pertama untuk mendoakan yang dianggap merintis sebuah desa. Without distinguishing religious identities, but driven by the same conception of local knowledge. it became clear that local knowledge is able to encourage tolerant practice in Dusun Jamuran. The last conclusion, tolerant and local genius. Local genius is a cultural practice of the local community that was born from dialectical process between local culture and foreign culture. The various local genius that are carried by Jamuran Villager are the result of the absorption of the value of tolerant, local tradition, and foreign cultures. This cultural integration become a tradition that continues to be practiced by Jamuran community until now. The knowledge base and value that underlay the practice of tolerant in Jamuran community are based on family value atau yang sebut yang sering dikenal dengan istilah philosophy of kekeluargaan. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you, Mr. Anas. Exactly in 10 minutes. Perfect. Okay. Go to next speaker. Before we go to next speaker, interesting delivery by Mr. Anas that the idea is religious tolerance based on local genius in social practice in Suku Dadi, Wagir, Malang Regency. We are going to the next speaker, Mr. Arfan Nusi. Mr. Arfan Nusi, as told by the committee, sent pre-recorded presentations. So the committee, you may share the video now.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Saya Arfan Nusi akan mempresentasikan artikel yang berjudul Adaptasi Warga Muhammadiyah terhadap Tradisi Keagamaan NU di Gorontalo. Kita ketahui persis bahwa Muhammadiyah dikenal dengan semangat modernisme dan puritanisme atau yang disebut dengan semangat pembaharuan maupun semangat pemurnian Islam. Sehingga tidak heran ketika semangat pembaharuan maupun pemurnian Islam berhadapan dengan tradisi atau kearifan lokal yang ada di setiap daerah, maka akan terjadi benturan. Nah, di Gorontalo ada fakta yang cukup menarik di mana warga atau kelompok dari Muhammadiyah itu disebut dengan mengakomodir tradisi yang ada di Gorontalo. Dan tradisi keagamaan ini yang kemudian ini yang selalu dijalankan oleh Nahdlatul Ulama dan itu juga dilaksanakan oleh warga Muhammadiyah pada umumnya. Jadi beberapa fakta yang terlihat di Gorontalo yakni terjalin pertemanan yang sejati tanpa disekat-sekat oleh perbedaan paham. Di sini muncul bahwa antara Muhammadiyah dan NU di Gorontalo sulit untuk membedakan identitas mereka karena memang tidak ada sekat-sekat perbedaan paham. Dan yang kedua, perjumpaan di ruang-ruang sosial dan keagamaan. Jadi setiap hari warga atau kelompok Muhammadiyah berjumpa dalam ruang sosial maupun dalam kegiatan-kegiatan keagamaan. Yang ketiga adalah warga NU pernah merasakan amaliyah Muhammadiyah dan begitu pun sebaliknya. Jadi di sini saya sebagai peneliti mengangkat tentang adaptasi warga Muhammadiyah terhadap tradisi keagamaan NU di Gorontalo. Adapun yang menjadi pertanyaan dalam penelitian ini, kami mengajukan tiga. Yang pertama adalah bagaimana wujud adaptasi warga Muhammadiyah dalam pelaksanaan tradisi keagamaan NU di Gorontalo? Yang kedua, faktor apa saja yang membuat warga Muhammadiyah melaksanakan tradisi keagamaan NU? Dan yang ketiga, apa implikasi yang terjadi ketika warga Muhammadiyah beradaptasi? Dari tiga pertanyaan ini akan dijawab dalam hasil penelitian nanti. Dalam penelitian ini, saya melakukan tinjauan pustaka. Yang pertama tulisan dari Pringle yang menulis tentang NU dan Muhammadiyah dalam interpretasi gender. Ada juga tulisan Zainal Arifin tentang sudut pandang dan metode NU dan Muhammadiyah. Ada juga tulisan Rofi'ah, konflik khilafiyah NU dan Muhammadiyah. Dan tulisan Widodo, prinsip keagamaan NU dan Muhammadiyah. Dari keempat tulisan ini, masing-masing masih lebih pada membandingkan cara pandang NU dan Muhammadiyah. Belum masuk atau belum menyentuh pada tataran bagaimana Muhammadiyah beradaptasi pada tradisi kegiatan, tradisi keagamaan Nahdlatul Ulama. Metode penelitian ini yakni menggunakan kualitatif yang memperoleh ya dengan memperoleh data yang bersifat etik dan emik, dan juga data ini bersifat naturalistik, kerja lapangan, serta deskriptif. Dalam hasil penelitian, saya mendapatkan sebuah fakta yang cukup menarik, di mana Muhammadiyah melaksanakan tradisi dalam wujud yakni berupa tahlilan, barzansi, yasinan, dan juga ada beberapa tradisi lokal yang dilaksanakan oleh warga Muhammadiyah, yakni hileya maupun tumbilotohe. Hileya itu dalam tradisi Gorontalo adalah menggeser makanan yang ada di rumah sendiri lalu diantarkan ke rumah tetangga yang berduka. Sementara tumbilotohe di sini adalah tradisi malam pasang lampu pada tanggal 27 Ramadan. Kemudian faktor yang menyebabkan warga Muhammadiyah beradaptasi adalah masing-masing saling terbuka. Di antara NU maupun Muhammadiyah saling terbuka, saling berinteraksi sehingga menyebabkan suasananya menjadi cair. Itu yang pertama. Kemudian yang kedua adalah warga menyatu dalam kepengurusan seperti MUI yang memiliki agenda yang sama, sedangkan kerjasama bagi masyarakat bisa, yakni terdapat dalam tradisi Huyula, seperti gotong royong, tiayo, atau tolong menolong. Tradisi ini terlihat jelas dalam kehidupan sehari-hari, misalnya dalam konteks tradisi Huyula antara Muslim Muhammadiyah dan Nahdlatul Ulama yang selalu melakukan gotong royong seperti memperbaiki jembatan, jalan, membersihkan kantor kelurahan, ataupun masjid. Implikasi yang dihasilkan adalah satu dan lainnya telah menyatu dalam balutan tradisi luhur. Jadi rupanya sikap ini merupakan representasi dari tenggang rasa atau penghormatan. Dalam bahasa Gorontalo disebut dengan tinepo. Jadi pembahasannya adalah bisa dilihat bahwa NU dan Muhammadiyah di Gorontalo sudah saling akomodatif, sudah saling adaptif, kerjasama maupun terbuka dalam hal-hal sosial maupun kegiatan keagamaan. Jadi saya kira ini presentasi kami. Mohon maaf apabila ada hal-hal yang kurang. Demikian, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Oke, thank you, committee. Mr. Nusi present his recorded video on the idea that adaptation of Muhammadiyah society to the religious traditional of Nahdlatul Ulama in Gorontalo. Some factor, his found some factors. namely Open Society and B, the same organization. Okay, we are going to the next speaker, Ms. Dewi Puspita Rahayu. Ms. Rahayu, the floor is yours.
Yeah. Terima kasih Bapak Muhaimin atas waktunya. Baik, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat pagi menjelang siang Bapak-Ibu sekalian. Pada kesempatan kali ini saya akan mempresentasikan penelitian saya yang berjudul Islamic Boarding School and Sanitation Problems, atau dalam bahasa Indonesia adalah Pondok Pesantren dan Masalah Sanitasi. Oke, saya full screen-kan dulu. Oke, adapun latar belakang dari penelitian ini adalah berangkat dari permasalahan pondok pesantren dalam membina dan menciptakan suatu keadaan yang sehat dalam lingkungan fisik pondok. Karena di beberapa pesantren itu masih rawan dalam penyediaan air bersih dan juga memiliki kerentanan dalam permasalahan sanitasi lingkungan. Salah satu pondok pesantren yang saya angkat di sini adalah pondok pesantren Darut Taqwa atau yang lebih dikenal dengan sebutan Pondok Malah yang ada di Kabupaten Pasuruan, tepatnya di Desa Sengon Agung, Kecamatan Purwosari. Dari sisi geografis, Desa Sengon Agung, Kecamatan Purwosari ini termasuk di dalam area pegunungan dan berbukit, dan dikategorikan sebagai wilayah yang memiliki tingkat kepadatan penduduk tertinggi di Kabupaten Pasuruan, ya, yakni mencapai sekitar 2.478 jiwa per kilometer persegi, yaitu di tahun 2016, dengan total jumlah penduduk mencapai 8.649 jiwa, dengan luas hanya 3,49 kilometer persegi. Pondok pesantren Darut Taqwa atau Pondok Ngalah ini merupakan salah satu gambaran mikro dari yang ada di Desa Sengon Agung, ya, berkaitan dengan tingkat kepadatan penduduknya gitu. Dan berdasarkan hasil observasi dari peneliti itu melihat beberapa kondisi yang itu berkaitan dengan permasalahan sanitasi lingkungan, ya, seperti kondisi pondok terutama yang asrama itu tidak rapi, terus kemudian kebersihan di dalam lingkungan pondok itu yang masih banyak sampah yang berserakan, ya, terutama di asramanya, terus kemudian pemakaian plastik yang tinggi, kondisi kamar tidur yang tidak ada dipan, jadi lesehan seperti itu, terus kemudian ada ruang mandi, cuci kakus, yang dan juga tempat sampah yang kurang memadai. Dan yang tidak kalah pentingnya juga masalah penyediaan air bersih, ya, di lingkungan pondok. Nah, di dalam penelitian ini saya mengangkat beberapa atau apa ya merujuk pada beberapa penelitian terdahulu. Jadi ada penelitian dari Ma'rufi tahun 2005 dan juga ada Astuti di tahun 2016. Yang Ma'rufi ini berbicara tentang faktor sanitasi lingkungan yang berperan terhadap prevalensi penyakit skabies di pesantren Kabupaten Lamongan. Dan juga ada dari Astuti, yaitu hubungan sanitasi pondok pesantren dengan kejadian ISPA di pondok pesantren As-Salafi Al-Fitrah Surabaya. Nah, di dalam penelitian ini saya ingin mengangkat, ya, masalah sanitasi lingkungan ini jika dikaitkan dengan pola perilaku masyarakat yang ada di dalam pondok pesantren tersebut gitu. Nah, dari sini saya bertujuan untuk menjelaskan yang pertama adalah mengapa permasalahan mengenai sanitasi lingkungan itu dapat terjadi di lingkungan pondok pesantren, dan yang kedua bagaimana upaya pondok pesantren dalam mengatasi permasalahan ini, dan juga kendala apa saja yang dialami oleh pondok pesantren dalam mewujudkan lingkungan yang saniter. Oke. Saya menggunakan teori perilaku sosial atau behavioralnya B.F. Skinner. Dari teori ini kemudian saya mencoba untuk mengelaborasikannya dan menghasilkan sebuah hipotesis bahwa tinggi atau rendahnya derajat ketercapaian pola hidup bersih dan sehat dan juga sanitasi lingkungan di pondok pesantren itu sangat erat kaitannya dengan kondisi lingkungan sekitar yang mempengaruhi perilaku warga yang tinggal di pondok pesantren tersebut gitu. Dalam hal ini lingkungan sekitar itu teman sepondok, ya, atau kemudian orang sekitar, lingkungan alam, desain serta kondisi infrastruktur tempat tinggal, dan juga tata aturan atau nilai dan norma yang berlaku di dalam pondok pesantren. saya di penelitian ini menggunakan metode kualitatif dengan pendekatan studi kasus. Teknik penentuan informannya purposif dan snowball. Nah, snowball di sini khusus ketika saya mencari informan dari para santri seperti itu, jadi saya menggunakan snowball. Dan teknik penggalian datanya adalah wawancara dan observasi. Oke, hasil dari penelitian ini menunjukkan bahwa terdapat faktor-faktor ya yang mempengaruhi perilaku hidup bersih dan sehat para santri yang meliputi dimensi fisik, sosial, dan budaya ya yang saling berhubungan dan mempengaruhi perilaku individu. Nah, di sini teridentifikasi ada dua perilaku, yaitu perilaku tidak bersih dan juga perilaku tidak sehat. Nah, perilaku tidak bersih ini dilihat dari kamar tidur yang berantakan, kemudian kamar mandi yang kotor, dan di beberapa bagian seperti pintu yang mengalami kerusakan dan halaman asrama yang terlihat kumuh karena sampah yang berserakan. Kemudian perilaku tidak sehat ini seperti pola konsumsi mie instan ya, yang sering dilakukan oleh para santri, dan kemudian perilaku konsumsi mie tersebut yang hanya menggunakan kantong plastik sebagai wadahnya. Jadi mereka jarang menggunakan piring ya untuk makan mie instan tersebut. Kemudian juga ada kondisi kamar tidur yang tanpa alas kasur, jadi tanpa dipan, jadi langsung aja kasur kapuk atau palembang yang ditaruh di lantai. Dan juga perilaku santri yang tidak secara rutin melakukan kegiatan bersih diri atau mandi. Nah, itu tadi temuan di lapangan, dan ini saya mencoba untuk menjawab mengapa hal tersebut bisa terjadi gitu. Nah, dari sini ada tiga dimensi lingkungan yang kemudian bisa mempengaruhi pola perilaku santri. Yang pertama adalah lingkungan fisik yang ada di Pondok Pesantren Ngalah, yang berupa lingkungan alam dan infrastruktur atau sarana prasarana pondok. Ya, jadi yang pertama adalah jumlah santri itu yang sangat banyak ya, dan itu tidak diimbangi dengan kapasitas asrama yang memadai. Jadi satu asrama itu diisi 300 santri dan satu kamar, tiap-tiap kamar itu diisi 17 sampai 20 orang dengan luas kamar sekitar 4 kali 5 meter persegi ya. Jadi sekitar 4 kali 5 meter, 20 meter persegi luasnya harus diisi dengan 20 orang, dan itu menyebabkan di dalam kamar tidak bisa diisi dipan, sehingga hanya tidur lesehan seperti itu. Bahkan meja untuk belajar pun tidak ada karena sudah sangat sesak di dalam kamar seperti itu. Terus kemudian faktor lingkungan fisik yang kedua adanya ini ya, kurangnya fasilitas MCK. Jadi dalam satu asrama itu terdapat sekitar 27 kamar mandi dengan komposisi ada 14 kamar mandi WC dan 12 kamar mandi shower, dan satu kamar atau area khusus untuk cuci baju dan piring. Ya, jadi fasilitas MCK ini ternyata tidak sinkron ya. Saya bisa mengatakan tidak sinkron dengan kondisi lingkungan geografis yang ada di pondok, di mana di pondok tersebut itu ketersediaan air itu sangat terbatas karena jauh dari sumber mata air. Jadi di sini memang wilayah yang sering atau rentan terjadi kekeringan dengan jumlah kamar mandi yang segitu banyak, dan dimodel dengan kamar mandi shower ini menyebabkan hanya setengah ya dari 27 kamar mandi ini yang bisa difungsikan seperti itu, karena selebihnya itu sudah tidak kebagian air lagi. Ya, kurang lebih gambarannya seperti itu. Dan dari faktor lingkungan fisik yang seperti ini mengakibatkan santri itu jarang mandi, karena santri yang banyak dengan kamar mandi yang tidak memadai ini membuat mereka harus mengantri, dan akibatnya mereka ya, karena santri ini kan posisinya santri dan juga sekolah di pagi harinya, sehingga mereka ini tidak sempat mandi karena ngantri kamar mandi itu. Nah, akhirnya membuat mereka itu jarang mandi. Nah, selain itu juga mereka menjadi kurang tidur karena mereka harus itu untuk mendapatkan air itu mereka harus bangun tengah malam jam 2 sudah bangun gitu ya untuk antri kamar mandi. Nah, ini membuat mereka mengantuk di saat sekolah. Terus kemudian ada juga perilaku merusak fasilitas kamar mandi. Biasanya ketika mereka sudah tidak tahan buang air atau itu tadi ya waktunya sudah mepet sudah harus sekolah, itu akhirnya perilaku-perilaku dalam tanda petik brutal gitu dengan merusak fasilitas ya, meluapkan emosi sehingga membuat fasilitas kamar mandi itu menjadi rusak. Tidur tidak teratur ya, terus kemudian belajar sambil tengkurap, nah itu juga terjadi karena fasilitas kamar yang tidak memadai itu tadi.
One minute left, Miss Dewi.
Okay. Ya, terima kasih. Okay, selanjutnya ada lingkungan sosial pondok pesantren. Jadi tadi selain lingkungan fisik, juga perilaku hidup tidak sehat dan tidak bersih para santri ini juga dipengaruhi oleh apa namanya pola interaksi yang ada di dalam pondok pesantren, terutama di dalam peer group-nya. Jadi di mana perilaku seperti mengkonsumsi mie instan itu juga direproduksi gitu di dalam kelompok peer group tersebut. Nah, selanjutnya ada lingkungan budaya. Jadi selain tadi lingkungan fisik, ini ada lingkungan budaya. Salah satunya yaitu nilai keislaman yang menjadi cerminan budaya Islam, yakni nilai tentang qanaah gitu ya. Jadi qanaah ini kemudian membuat manusia itu dilarang untuk mengeluh dan mendorong untuk manusia itu untuk harus selalu menerima kondisi yang ada sebagai sebuah rezeki yang patut disyukuri. Dan hal inilah yang kemudian membuat para santri itu menerima apa adanya gitu dengan kondisi lingkungan sosial dan lingkungan fisik yang ada di pondoknya. Okay.
Last chance for conclusion, Mr. Miss Dewi.
Okay, thank you. Upaya pondok pesantren dalam pemasangan sanitasi lingkungan ini, pondok pesantren melakukan reinforcement atau penguatan yang bekerja sama dengan IWINS. Selanjutnya ada kendala dalam penerapan program. Jadi kendalanya yaitu kesenjangan konsep program dengan realitas lingkungan. Terus kemudian kekurangan aktifan para santri kader untuk mengikuti program pelatihan dan seminar dalam upaya reinforcement itu tadi. Terus kemudian ada masalah tidak adanya aturan tertulis yang mengatur bagaimana sistem keorganisasian asrama dijalankan dalam pesantren. Ini adalah kesimpulannya. Di sini
Okay, time is up. We got your conclusions. Thank you, Ms. Dewi, for your presentation. Interesting deliver by Ms. Dewi that the research on Islamic boarding school and sanitation problems in Pasuruan are not only related to the behavior of students, but also lack of facilities. Okay, we are going to the next speaker. Mr. Padamian Daulay and Ms. Nur Afni Hafso.
Okay, yes, very
good. Yeah, the time is yours.
Okay, thank you for the occasion, Mr. Muhaimin Zul, that I would like to deliver my presentation titled The Resilience of the Tabligh Jamaah During the COVID-19 Period. This paper written by Mr. Pardamain Daulay from Department of Sociology, Faculty of Law, Social Science, and Politics in Open University, Universitas Terbuka. And also me from Department of Sociology of Religion, Faculty of Usuluddin and Islamic Thought, UIN Sunan Kalijaga, Yogyakarta. We are both associate the alumni from the postgraduate program from FISIP Universitas Brawijaya. Next to the second page from the introduction. This paper written because of many background. The first COVID-19 has many impacts, not only in health and the economic side, but also in people religious pattern. You know that many researchers do research in economic and health perspective, but we agree that this is because they realize that those we feel in the real condition. But there is a fact that COVID-19 also changed religious pattern. And the second, COVID-19 can give rise to a new model of racism and xenophobia in religious communities in Indonesia. This is shown by the outlook of the community to the Tabligh Jamaah. In the early pandemic in 2020, Najwa Shihab released the video about rejection of the people who infected by COVID-19. Yeah, moreover, the society also reject the funeral procession. It also happened to the community of Jamaah Tabligh. This issue is spreading to the religious ritual. And the third, Tabligh Jamaah conduct in ijtima ulama in the midst of the increasing number of COVID-19 in Indonesia. Ijma ulama is the religious gathering of Tabligh Jamaah communities from various countries. This event not only attended by Jamaah Tabligh community in Indonesia, but also from the many countries such as India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Malaysia, Taiwan, and etc. They forced to help this agenda even though the government and most people in Indonesia shown the rejection. So it raises the discrimination and sentiment to the Jamaah Tabligh community. And the fourth, improving the relationship between group member and increasing the intensity of worship in one of the escape for member of the Tabligh Jamaah in responding to alignment in the community. When they got sentiment from the society, then they changed the adapt their religious practice. Next. This problem formulation in this paper, the first, how did the social religious life of the Tabligh change during the COVID-19 period? And the second, how can sentiment toward religious sect occur in the people, and how to change the and adapt religious practice in responding to community discrimination? Next, we use this theory for religious commitment theory from Kulok and Stark that contain five dimensions. First, dimension of religious faith, dimension of religious practice, dimension of appreciation, dimension of religious knowledge, and consequential dimension. Next, in the fifth slide, we are going to the method that this this paper research in Kejajar District, Wonosobo, Central Java, Indonesia. We use type of research, qualitative field, and data research, primary and secondary. From primary, we did interview to the Jamaah Tabligh and their family, also some people in the location of the research. And document that we use such a Fadha'il Amal book, that means some that is the main book of the Jamaah Tabligh. And also some research document, etc. Next, in the sixth. Now, we are going to the discuss for this paper, the Tabligh Jamaah Religious Social Change. During the pandemic, it is not allowed to hold event that invite a lot of people. However, the Tabligh Jamaah actually carry out the ijtima ulama activity, which were attended by Tabligh Jamaah followers from various countries. Jamaah Tabligh had reason why they continues to carry out the ijtima ulama, because they had prepared many things for that big event, and they already spent much money for doing that activity. And the impact of holding the ijtima ulama during the pandemic has brought the Tabligh Jamaah into a religious organization that many people talk about. It is trending not only in Twitter actually, but also in other social media. So it means it raises the judgment for the public from the Jamaah Tabligh. And embedding the Tabligh Jamaah as a cluster for the spread of COVID-19, increasing public sentiment toward the Tabligh Jamaah group during the COVID-19 pandemic. When they come back to their home and the environment, many rejection was happened, especially for their neighbor. Their neighbor were afraid in infected COVID-19 that carried out by the Jamaah Tabligh who were back from Goa, the place that the agenda held, where ijtima ulama was held. And then adaptation in the Tabligh Jamaah group are carried out in the tackling public sentiments, such as the carrying out worship in the spread, reducing dakwah activity, means the spreading religious teaching, and in increasing solidarity among members of the Tabligh Jamaah. They realize that society don't give the space to their activity anymore, so they change the religious activity. Next. The community's discrimination against religious sect, Tabligh in this a paper specific in Tabligh Jamaah. The first, the society showed their rejection in many ways, such as spraying disinfectant on the worship tool of the Tabligh Jamaah. Commonly, people in Kejajar, the field research, put their worship tools such as sajadah or praying rock, tasbih, praying beads on the other mosque or musola, means small mosque. They spreading disinfectants especially for the some tools belong to Jamaah Tabligh. It means they reject that the existence of the Jamaah Tabligh in that mosque, and stay away when meeting members of the Tabligh Jamaah. It is a funny experience actually when there is accident happen when one of the people the man fell down from the motorbike, and then member of the Tabligh Jamaah want to help. However, the person immediately ran away because of the negative stigma against the Tabligh congregation who were considered to the spreading the COVID-19 virus. It makes the Jamaah Tabligh worried about the position in society. And the third, not visiting the homes of members of the Tabligh Jamaah in Kejajar's sub-district, it is very common for people to visit each other. But when the Tabligh congregation cluster occurred, people no longer want to visit the house of the Jamaah Tabligh who had just returned from the Goa Ijtima' Ulama event. This happened for several months. This is one of the things that makes member of the Tabligh congregation feel the alienation in the society. And gossiping about member of the Tabligh Jamaah congregation, we know that one of the most powerful social control in social is gossip. Yeah, this is done by the Kejajar community toward the Tabligh congregation and their family. Next, we then talk about the change and adaptation of religious practice in responding to community discrimination. The first congregation ritual. So actually, Jamaah Tabligh has some rituals such as huruj, jaulah, and taklim. Yeah, huruj mean the method of preaching the Tabligh Jamaah by moving and having a certain period in of the time. But before pandemic is routine, but after pandemic they remove that activity. Jaulah, inviting people to do good thing. Usually door to door, but yeah, after pandemic is removed also. And taklim, reading the book of Fadhail Amal. Fadhail Amal is a main book for the Tabligh Jamaah. Yeah, they still do taklim, but held secretly, so that's not a public. Restriction of the religious activity were reduced in accordance with the direction of the Central Tabligh Jamaah. The Tabligh Jamaah does not fight against community resistance. Instead, it is getting stronger by established solidarity among other members of the Tabligh Jamaah, such as the rising fund for the member of the Tabligh Jamaah and family who are self-isolation in a hospital, and they provide moral support. Next, number 9 pages. Okay, congregation faith macro. There are 4 dimensions in the theory, one dimension of religious faith. They say, we came to Goa to achieve the pleasure of Allah and the messenger of Allah. So if we die here, we will be shahid. Yeah, sociologists change in this case is such as the good big issue, because they think that they go to Ijtima' Ulama even though the people rejected agenda. They think that this is a good thing because they believe that when they die in the journey to reaching the Goa, they will be shahid. Yeah. And then dimension of appreciation. The practice given by Mrs. Nyai Magela, he practiced that what I do given to come in. I mean like this, when the people, when the people come to, they practice religious practice recommended by the religious leader. So Nyai Magelang is one of the leader of Jamaah Tabligh. She gave the amalan. Amalan means worship pedoman ya. This is to treat themselves from the problem they face when they aligned by society. So amalan-amalan give their peaceful in their life. Okay, the last. As the result, the exclusion of this group occurred after the ijtima ulama participant returned home. The exclusion occurred not only to congregation who follow the ijtima ulama, but also their families. The study examined change in the social religious life of the tabligh jamaah and community sentiment towards religious sects during the COVID-19 period in Wonosobo Regency, Central Java. The study found that socio-religious life of the tabligh jamaah experienced a shift due to increasing public sentiment toward religious groups. Change in group religious ritual adapt to social condition, even though they are contrary to religious belief and obedience. So that new ritual practice are carried out to the survive the larger sentiment. That's all. Thank you for the occasion. Back to the
thank you. Okay. Thank you, Miss Afni. 10 minutes, perfect. Interesting presentation by Ms. Afni that the ideas, the resilience of the tabligh jamaah during the COVID-19 period in Kijajar District, Wonosobo Regency, Central Java. The tabligh jamaahs are also implementing new strategies to adapt the changing public response. Okay, we are going to the next speaker, Ms. Titi Fitrianita Ucha Arawinda. The floor is yours.
Okay, good morning everyone. Thank you Pak Muhammad Zul for the time that given to me. Let me introduce myself. My name is Titi Fitrianita and Ucha Arawinda as the team for this research presented here. And I would like to present my research. This research was conducted in 2020 and we conducted this research by getting grant, yearly grant from Faculty of Social, Political and Social Sciences, Brawijaya University. So the topic here is the role of religious leaders in HIV, AIDS prevention and management in Malang City. There are several backgrounds why this research is important. Okay, so the number of HIV in Indonesia is quite high, with the number of HIV and AIDS more than 50,000 cases in 2008, and with the number of case fatality around 1.03%, and this figure is predicted to increase the next year due to the more intensive detection of HIV. It means that HIV is quite a serious problem in Indonesia. And Indonesia, HIV is usually associated with immoral and vicious behavior, like, you know, like casual sex or changing partner, homosexuality, adultery, and drug use. It's actually make them become being stigmatized and discriminated by the society, and this condition bring them to be more closed status rather than open to avoid social stigma and discrimination. And the one thing that's interesting is religion is the source, one of the source why stigma and discrimination is happening to the people living with HIV. But the other side, a lot of studies showed that actually religion, especially spirituality itself, has played an important role in the prevention and handling HIV/AIDS, especially for coping strategy and for people living with HIV, it significantly reduced depression. So that is why religions become an important role for prevention and management in HIV, and that's why UN, United Nations, adopt this approach for overcoming the HIV around the world. Besides that, a lot of studies showed that religious leaders is actually able to overcome social problems, and they are having capacity to persuade people to be able to move together and mobilizing positive social change. And it includes HIV actually, but it seems that in Indonesia, religious approach is not really become a concern. And we did research in Malang. Why Malang? Because Malang was a national pilot city in Indonesia for the efforts to prevent and manage HIV AIDS, especially for medical approach. And Malang also was the second largest number of HIV AIDS sufferers in East Java after Surabaya, where East Java itself is the province with the second largest number of people which got HIV AIDS in Indonesia. So this study were intended to analyze the role of religious leaders in Malang in prevention and management of HIV AIDS, whether they are included in the prevention and management of HIV AIDS or they are not, and how far they are being included in this prevention and management of HIV AIDS. So we collected data by using qualitative method, using case study, and we collected data by in-depth interviews, observation, and using documentation. We did select around 12 informants, which is from Muslim, from Christian, from Catholic, from Buddhist, and Hindu leaders in Malang. So we did interview by hybrid, using hybrid because of pandemic situation. In 2020, was quite safer condition at that time. We did offline and online interview to get the data. And the data, we did analyze the data by using Myers and Haverman technical analysis data, and we did data triangulation. And what did we found? What did we find? So most of religious leaders, just like any other studies showed that they, most of them, is actually linked at the practice of free sex. So HIV is linked to the practice of free sex, which actually occasionally associated with prostitution, casual sex or changing partners, and homosexual. Rarely they see that HIV AIDS is linked to drug use. Yeah. So because of this knowledge, HIV AIDS will always be a moral issues against religious teaching. I would say this is an uncomprehensive knowledge. We say that this is uncomprehensive knowledge because they don't really know that there's actually a woman who live in the house who has been infected by their partner because of their partner. You know, they do casual sex with other women or doing homosexual action with other men, or kids who is infected by their mother. They do not really know this fact. So this is what we call as uncomprehensive knowledge. I think this is because they are more concerned, these religious leaders is more concerned to take care of their monotheism and piety stuff in their religion rather than overcoming social issues, including this HIV AIDS. And the second thing is that we found that HIV is a bad consequences or punishment from human who break God's prohibition. I think this is very uncommon. This is very common for lots of religion, because lots of religion actually prohibit their followers to break God's prohibition, like, you know, like what I said, prostitution, casual sex, changing partners, and homosexual. And the things that I found as well in this research is HIV AIDS is for religious leader is not related to monetization and piety. I think this is a good point why they don't really see HIV AIDS as a concern or piety social issues to overcome. Yeah, this is why they don't have a priority concern overcoming the issue. And since there are no data on the number of people living with HIV AIDS among their followers, the religious leaders have not yet coordinated with related parties creating programs to overcome HIV AIDS. I think this is a quite contradiction because if people who are living with HIV AIDS open their status, they would face the stigma and discrimination. That is why they close their status. But at the other side, I think it is quite important to know the data based on religion to make a religious leader shocked and make them to move from their standing point to make an action to overcoming problem, because this is not just a social issues, but also a religious issues among their followers. But however, even though religious leaders see this HIV issues only related with monotheism or religious issues, but they actually did several efforts. They, like Catholic Church, they have a program called as PSE, or socioeconomic development, that address such as the economic problem of Catholics followers, their followers, such as pre-sex behavior with spiritual approach. Hindu leaders as well, they also implemented a clean and holy behavior, began with BFDS program for their followers, including avoid their followers from pre-sex and drugs. Also, Christianity churches carried out conditional lectures and mentoring either by pastors during lectures or by inviting outsiders who are experts in the field of HIV/AIDS to commemorate certain days related to it, especially for young people and also for parents. And also Muslim leaders actually did a sermon in mosque about the danger of HIV/AIDS. So it doesn't mean that they don't really do something. They did something, but they just don't see HIV as their main concern, because they think that there are still lots of main concerns to take over for their daily routine as a religious leaders. But the good things also, the religious leaders are willing to be included and aware of their role to overcome these issues. I think this is a good point. This is just, we just need one step to make them being included, because they are willing to be able to overcome together with other parties to overcome these issues. And also, they're also aware that religious leaders themselves are aware of multi-sectoral coordination for prevention and management HIV/AIDS. I think this is also a good point for religious leader in Mala to have a coordination with other parties, like non-government organization or government itself, to make a multi-sectoral effort to tackle this issue, considering that Malang was the second largest HIV sufferers in East Java. So what is the conclusion from this research? So religious leaders, it actually has provided guidance to their followers through ceremonies, lecture, or station to stay away from pre-sex. This effort can directly become an effort to prevent HIV transmission based on spiritual or spiritual strengthening. I think this is a good thing, but they don't see this as a good thing, because they see just this is just a regular sermon, this is just a regular lecture, but they don't really point at their efforts to overcoming this problem. And the second thing is, religious leaders could also become strategic actors in HIV/AIDS countermeasure by fully accept the repentance of people who violate the teachings of God religion, those especially who have been sexual sex, which actually become one solution to reduce the stigma of people living with HIV in society. I mean, like people living with HIV not only facing pressure from society, but they also having a quiet pressure themselves, you know, within themselves. So because of repentance process, I think this is the way of people among the followers, among religious followers, to accept them fully, because they are no longer become a sinner. I think this is a big, the way of a religious leader as spirit, a strategic leader, strategic position for religious leader to accept and reduce stigma and discrimination of people living with HIV in society, especially for among their followers. I think that it's the end of my presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Miss Titi. Interesting delivery by Miss Titi in 10 minutes. Perfect. That research on the role of religious leaders in HIV/AIDS prevention and management in Malang City. Some results are the religious leaders have not yet coordinated with related parties. However, several efforts have been made and they are willing to be included in such program. Okay, we are going to our last speaker, Mr. Yusli. Are you there, Mr. Yusli?
Yes, I'm here, Muhammad.
Okay. Mr. Yusli, the floor is yours.
Okay, good day, everyone. So I had the last presentation to be filled. I'm going to talk about securitization of the I must to reduce the screen. I'm going to talk about securitization of extremism in Indonesia under Jokowi administration. So disclaimer must be put forward because I'm not a pro for any extremism or any radical group in Indonesia, but this is the study for assessing how state exerting power to their society. This is my organization of talk. I will talk about several issues on extremism in Indonesia. Yeah. And then I go talk about findings and the theory I am employing to research and the conclusion. This is the introduction. So the terrorism has the impact in Indonesia. So we got like a globalization of countering or preventing violent extremism because United Nations has shifted this strategy from reactionary policies to preventive policies. So this is the case also in Indonesia. Indonesia government have altered their strategy from reactive policies, put more on and focusing more on discriminating the or criminalizing the terrorists. Now Indonesian government try to implement the preventive policies. But the criticism has must be highlighted that the policies deficiency. The policy has been dubbed as a top-down fragmented and lack of consistency. So because the government has tried to convince people to believe that extremism is become the existential threat. So there are battle of ideas and this battle has also divided society into camps like a moderate camp and radical Muslim, pro Pancasila or anti Pancasila and so on and so on. And why I study this subject because I'm not trying to say that I am the first to study the securitization of extremism, but it is hard to find that the similar study because the most of study talk about the securitization of terrorism and not on extremism. So there are initial finding. This is actually not of accomplished research, but I have to highlight some initial finding. The first is about the vagueness of radicalism. This is meaning that in many cases in Indonesia, radicalism has been exchanges with terrorism in several cases. So people must be confused whether to identify is it radicalism or extremism or terrorism. And the other thing that I found is about the police militarization, because the successful move of securitization. So extremism is perceived as the threat of the Indonesian integrity. So the police itself try to be a soldier, try to overcome the situation by discriminating and also criminalizing extremists or terrorists as a person that must be posited as a criminal against humanity. And the other thing is about to show is that many anti-terrorism regulation enacted as a process of executive process, not from the legislative process. This is what we call by soft law. And the other thing is about the Islamocentric in and fighting or narrative of anti-terrorism, because we found in many monographs and publication there are many identical issues in associating Islam with terrorism or extremism. So this is how we see that extremism is fine to differentiate with other concept like radicalism or extremism. But in Indonesia, there are several deficiencies in defining the extremism, because extremism actually, in similar cases, identical to radicalism. So that's why I put a slash, or I put radicalism as identical to extremism in this case. This is the strategy that our soldier, TNI, try to implement in fighting extremism, because they see that extremism or terrorism is the existential threat of Indonesia. They try to implement war model in fighting terrorists or extremists, while in democratic state, it is better to see terrorism or extremism as a criminal justice case. So the big difference between these two models is, in war model, you are trying to appease the terrorism issue by making it like existential or security issues. While in criminal justice system, you try to proceed extremism as a morally criminal issues. So how to move from extremism as non-security issues to a securitized one? I use the theory of securitization. This is the theory as how you use discursive or non-discursive practices to convince a relevant masses or relevant audience to believe that something you are, that they are not security issues, are become security issues. And we know that terrorism is security issues, but not for the case of extremism. But because the government tried to convince people, tried to convince a relevant mass that extremism has also become an existential threat. Now we see that there are many extraordinary measures to use, to implement, to curb extremism. So in securitization, you have several security concepts. The first is military security. And then political security, and the other is social security. When we are talking about extremism, there are a threat forwarding to these three concepts of security. If we talk about extremism, the state try to convince our Indonesian fellow that extremism is also threatening to our state ideology, meaning Pancasila, and our Indonesianness or identity, national identity. So because the securitization about discursive practices, the government, Jokowi administration, try to convince people, but there are two camps that try to influence each other in winning the public discourse on Islam, or in security issues. They are moderate camp and radical Muslim camp. Because the securitization try to divide these people into two camp, we are now seeing the people are try to identify themselves whether in moderate camp or in radical one. The other discourse they are try to convince in the state, in our society, is about the state on the official ideology. So every ideology that try to replace Pancasila is dubbed as the antithetical to Pancasila. And the other discourse is about sovereignty and of our state. Now, due to the securitization move has been done by our government, there are many radical groups has been outlawed as a threat to our society. They are become an existential threat to our ideology, and they are become the threatening group of our national identity. There are several statements has been spoken by our official or our ministries, like Muldoko, Kepala Kantor Staf Presiden, said that JAD merongrong Pancasila, while Wiranto, as Menko Polhukam, convince people that HTI mengancam kedaulatan negara. Well, our Minister of Religious Affairs, Pak Lukman Hakim Saifuddin, believe that some radical group try to replace our ideology with their Islamic militant ideologies. and Minister of Internal Affairs Pak Cahyokumolo state as well that HTI is ormas to anti Pancasila. This is the regulation that has been enacted from the executive side to convince people that extremism become the existential threat. And this is the some practices, and we are talking about non-discursive practices, has been carried out by our government. This is the implementation of policies and action to convince relevant audience that extremism now become existential threat to our state. The first is about dissolution of HTI, HTI, Hizbut Tahrir Indonesia, pembubaran, and then the second is the ban of Jamaah Ansarud Daulah in 2018, and then the enactment of anti-terrorism law in 2020, and some other regulation also has been renewed to implement or to strengthen this position by purpose presidential decree number 35 in 2020. And also there are many action has been done by government to convince people that there are many many issues of extremism has been curbed, like many students are now trying to interested in extremism idea. So deputy of PMK, Ministry of Human PMK, what I recall PMK, that initially they try to initiate a section focusing on religious moderation. I have several issues.
Sorry for interrupting, Mr. Risley. You have 1 minute left.
Okay, so 1 minute or 2 minutes left?
1 minute left.
So on securitization, you have to do two fall activities. The first is about discursive practices and the other is non-discursive practices. When you talk about discursive practices, you are trying to talk about speech act. This is the grammar of security to convince relevant audience like government elites or critical mass to believe that you are trying to move some non-security issues to security issues. And when you talk about non-discursive issues, you try to implement that idea into reality. So this is the move about moving something issues on non-security to become non-security issues. And at the end, you have the privilege, you have the legitimacy to implement extraordinary measure to tackle the situation. So this is the last the last slide. My conclusion is that our president Jokowi administration has shifted terrorism securitization to extremism securitization. Now we see that extremism is not only threatening, but also something that has been handled in extraordinary action, like you are using TNE or they are dubbed as criminal in some situation. Second is securitization of radicalism or extremism also is the act to delegitimize some radical group in Indonesia. And this is the last notion that radical movement proceeded as the existential threat for Indonesian political and social security. Thank you. That's all from me. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Risley. Interesting presentation by Mr. Risley that conduct research on securitization of extremism, radicalism in Indonesia under Joko Widodo. CNPVE government strategies are shifting. The several findings are factors of radicalism, anti-terrorism, regulation based on executive agendas. And I think there are more findings yet. Okay. Actually, I am asking for the committee. Do we have any extra time to run Q&A? Because on schedule, we have time until 11:30, and now we got 11:30. But not yet answered. Dear committee, are you there, committee? Actually, and on schedule, it is very rush and strict time, yeah, limited given by the committee. I'm sorry for that. For the next session, start also in the same time when we finish. But okay,
but we have. It's better to have like extra time for 5 or 10 minutes. It's okay.
Okay. Yeah, we spend. Okay, we spend time about 10 minutes. Okay, the first question is on the chat box to Ms. Afni. Why Jamaah Tablighi are still managing face-to-face interaction? Is this related to the solidarity among groups members? Yeah, about maybe answer in 2 minutes. Yeah.
Okay, thank you for the occasion. I would like to answer the question from Ms. Titi Fitrianita. Thank you for the question. She talked about the interaction from the Jamaah Tablighi. Yeah. Basically, in the religion, in Jamaah Tablighi perspective, understanding, they do not believe in existence of the virus 19. They deny the existence of the virus. They believe that the virus was made by Allah, by God. And when they want to get rid of the virus, they should request to God the willingness willingness from the, a grace from the God to eliminate it by praying and following religious practices. And they adapt to religious change because of the rejection from the society, not because of the, they believe in the impact of coronavirus. So what they do is reduce contact, reduce the problem, reduce with with the community, not defending from the virus infection. So furthermore, they do a temporary decrease in the intensity of religious activity, as doing taklim, huruj, and etc. When the sentiment goes down and the COVID is not longer being a big issue in for the community, they will continue their activity like before pandemic era. So, so the result of my paper is the decreasing of the activity from Jamaah Tablighi is not from they know about coronavirus, they don't believe that, but to decrease the sentiment and discrimination in the society. That's all. Thank you, Mr.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Afni, for your answer. We have another questions to Ms. Titi. How the religious values distribute in terms of I think you can write in the chat box, Ms. Titi, because there are also arguments also. Yeah.
Thank you, Pak Mohaimin. Thank you, Mas Didit, for the question. I would like to answer the question by using bahasa. I think more fluent by using bahasa rather than my English. My English is not that good. Jadi, Mas Didit tanya apakah ada nilai-nilai keagamaan dalam ceramah di masjid sebagai upaya pencegahan HIV/AIDS. Yang biasa dilontarkan adalah menghindari free-sex, sudah pasti menghindari free-sex, menghindari perzinahan, istilahnya adalah seperti itu kalau dalam konteksnya Islam. Kemudian kalau dalam konteksnya Hindu, ada lagi bahasa yang kemudian disampaikan dalam konteks bahasa. Jadi setiap bahasa, setiap agama itu memiliki bahasa yang khusus dalam menyampaikan upaya pencegahan HIV/AIDS, terutama dalam konteks menghindari perzinahan. Jadi ada bahasa khusus yang disampaikan masing-masing agama. Kemudian adakah pendekatan khusus? Tidak ada pendekatan khusus. Yang biasa digunakan adalah menggunakan bahasa-bahasa agama itu Dan saya mohon untuk mengoreksi bahwa yang awal itu saya mengatakan bahwa sebenarnya semua pemimpin agama itu mendekati semua hal itu berdasarkan sudut pandang monoteisme dan paiti atau kesalehan seperti itu. Jadi tidak ada unsur kontradiktif sebenarnya dalam konteks peran pemimpin agama ini dalam hal penanggulangan dan pencegahan HIV/AIDS. Kemudian untuk pertanyaan yang nomor 2, apakah ada model produksi pengetahuan di antara para tokoh agama? Sejauh yang kami dapatkan atau adakah kemudian dialog lintas agama, sejauh yang kami dapatkan tidak ada. Tidak ada dialog lintas agama sebagai upaya penanganan HIV/AIDS. Kemudian juga tidak ada model produksi pengetahuan yang baru di antara tokoh agama terkait dengan HIV/AIDS. Jadi mereka tetap berada pada ranah di mana HIV/AIDS itu akan selalu dikontekskan dengan perilaku yang buruk gitu ya, seperti yang saya bilang tadi, apa bertukar partner, homoseksualitas dan lain sebagainya. Dan memang itu yang terjadi secara faktual. HIV/AIDS itu kan memang disebarkan lewat hal-hal yang seperti itu, meskipun ada aktor pasien lain ya yang menderita HIV/AIDS, tapi tidak disebabkan langsung oleh faktor itu, seperti yang saya contohkan, misalkan ibu rumah tangga yang kena dari suaminya misalnya, seperti itu. Jadi sebab utamanya HIV/AIDS dengan apa yang diketahui itu sebenarnya inline, tetapi memang masing-masing agama itu memang berjalan sendiri-sendiri dengan upayanya sendiri-sendiri di pada followers mereka masing-masing. Jadi tidak ada upaya bersama. Saya pikir kemudian menjadi penting sebenarnya ketika mereka mengerti bahwa ini juga adalah masalah yang dihadapi oleh jemaatnya mereka, maka ada usaha untuk secara bersama-sama, secara multisektoral untuk bisa menanggulangi HIV/AIDS ini. Itu yang bisa saya sampaikan. Terima kasih.
Okay, Miss Titi. Thank you for your clarification and answers. Any question, participants? We have 3 minutes left from our 10 minutes extra time. Participant also can ask live questions. Open mic and deliver the questions, please.
Tanya buat Bu Dewi, Pak.
Monggo, Pak.
Buat Bu Dewi yang pertanyaan soal pesantren tadi. Jadi, solusi apa yang realistis yang bisa secara cepat membantu pesantren untuk lebih higienis dengan kekurangan-kekurangan tadi itu, dengan kecilnya kamar mandi, terus sedikitnya tenaga kebersihan dan sebagainya. Itu aja, Pak.
Okay. Miss Dewi.
Ya, terima kasih Pak Yusli atas pertanyaannya. Tadi saya sudah sempat menyampaikan beberapa saran gitu ya terkait permasalahan yang ada di dalam pondok pesantren. Menurut saya memang solusi yang sangat bisa dilakukan adalah ini apa namanya peran pemerintah, terutama pemerintah daerah gitu, karena kalau kita lihat di kondisi faktualnya ini peran pemerintah sangat minim gitu, bahkan yang apa ya yang menggandeng pondok pesantren untuk memperhatikan masalah sanitasi lingkungan ini adalah hanyalah dari LSM gitu, bahkan LSM luar negeri. Nah ini mungkin peran pemerintah dari dinas kesehatan seperti itu di level yang terkecil lah seperti puskesmas ini bisa gitu ya, kemudian masuk ke dalam ini pondok-pondok pesantren ya, terutama di wilayah-wilayah yang di situ memang terindikasi banyak pondok pesantren itu, untuk kemudian bersama-sama ya membangun ya masyarakat yang itu berperilaku hidup bersih dan sehat seperti itu Pak Yusli. Kalau dari saya seperti itu ya, kembali ke pemerintah.
Okay, yeah. Thank you, Ms. Day. Due to the strict and rush limited time, so it is now time for close the sessions. Thank you all for your presentations. Good luck for your next research and study projects as the intellectual exercise in academic circumstance. I'm Mohamed Zulhair. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Mr. Muhaimin.
Thank you. Mbak Dewi, tulisannya ditunggu jurnal Pustu, Sosti Pesantren.
Oh.
Panas lama.
Itu Pak Yusli yang minta tadi harusnya gitu.
Oh, seperti itu. Ya.
Bu Dewi, masih studi di UB atau dosen di mana?
Oh, saya dosen, Pak, di UB.
Oh, enggak kenal ya?
Iya.
Fakultas apa, Bu?
Sosiologi, Pak. Oh. Ini sama-sama panas.
Oh, Bu Dewi yang kurawiri di gedung situ karena pakai masker, saya enggak lihat mukanya gitu. Jadi baru tahu sekarang gitu.
Iya, Pak.
Itu panas
selama lagi Pak Yusli. Enggak
pernah dibantu pemerintah soalnya itu.
Yusli, apakah WC-nya Gontor sudah bersih?
Toiletnya? Lama jadi santri nggak ada Pak, kepedulian negara itu nggak ada Pak. Jadi itu Pak Anas tuh selama jadi santri kayaknya nggak pernah juga diurusi negara itu.
Ampun.
Iya Pak.
Monggo pamit dulu. Dewi
yang
pamit ya, dulu monggo.
Masih kasih, terima kasih.
Mbak Dewi.
Ya, sama-sama, Bapak.
very much to all the participants who already joined us in the second panel session of the second APTE International Conference 2021. And after this, we will have a break for 45 minutes until 12:30 West Indonesian time. So you may take your time to refresh, and we expect you to be back on time for the next agenda. Thank you very much.